Dear friends and colleagues, my name is Serhiy Synhaivsky, and I'm Programs Director of Harvard Ukrainian Summer Institute. We are moving forward with our seminar series, and today we'll learn about a fascinating, yet little explored, little known topic, the Ukrainian engagement with Africa, on the example of Serhiy Synhaivsky's first novel, The Road to Asmara, based on real experiences of its author in the 1980s, then an interpreter and Soviet military officer stationed in Ethiopia, then under communist regime. Our today's speaker is Dr. Vitaly Chernetsky, professor of Slavic languages and literatures at the University of Kansas, where he was promoted to the rank of a full professor just this past July the 1st. So my congratulations. A native of the great city of Odessa, Professor Chernetsky received his BA from Moscow State University, and then became one of the first students from Ukraine to pursue graduate studies in the United States, first at Duke University, and then at the University of Pennsylvania, where he did his PhD in comparative literatures. After that, our speaker taught or did research at a number of prestigious academic institutions, such as Columbia University, Harvard Ukrainian Research Institute, Northeastern University, Miami University, Ohio, and finally, University of Kansas. He's the author of a groundbreaking study of post-communist cultures in Russia and Ukraine, titled Mapping Post-Communist Cultures, Russia and Ukraine in the Context of Globalization, published by McGill-Queen's University Press in 2007, and then in Ukrainian in 2013. His numerous articles deal with modern and contemporary Slavic and East European literatures in cross-disciplinary context. His Ukrainian language book, titled Intersections and Breakthroughs, Ukrainian Literature and Cinema Between the Global and the Local, is forthcoming in Ukraine's one of the best publishing houses, Kritika, and I hope it'll happen rather soon. Aside from being a serious scholar, Vitaly is also a prolific translator. And I wonder where does he has time to do all of this. Among his translations is a bilingual anthology of contemporary Ukrainian poetry titled Letters from Ukraine, published in 2016, and two translations of Yuri Andruhovich's signature novels, Moskoviad in 2008 and 12 Circles in 2015, as well as the volume of Andruhovich's Soviet poems titled Songs for a Dead Rooster, published in 2018, together with Ostap Kin. Professor Chernetsky is also an editor of the Ukrainian publications at Academic Studies Press. Last but not least, he's the vice president and learned secretary of the Shevchenko Scientific Society in the United States. And I probably forgot to mention a few other important achievements of Professor Chernetsky. I only hope that he'll forgive me for these omissions. I'm grateful that he's found time to join us here today. I'm sure he's in the middle of writing, editing, or translating just another piece of literature or scholarship. So thank you again, Vitaly, for this opportunity for us today to hear this story. Before I give the floor to our distinguished speaker, I would like to remind our knowledge distinguished audience that you can all pose your questions to our speaker by using the Q&A section on your Zoom screens, and the discussion will follow our presentation. So now please join me in welcoming Professor Vitaly Chernetsky. The virtual floor is yours.
Hello, everyone, and thank you so much for joining the event. Serhiy, thank you so much for your sweet and generous introduction. It is wonderful to have this opportunity to speak to the Harvard Ukrainian Summer Institute. Even if though we are virtual now, the virtual talks have been wonderful in that they allow us to reach audience members from many corners of our world. So thank you everyone for being here. As Serhiy mentioned, my topic today, my focus is a wonderful novel by contemporary Ukrainian author Serhiy Synhaivsky, The Road to Asmara, Doroga na Asmaru, and I will be glad to tell more about the book. So I will now share screen for my short PowerPoint, which I will not overburden you with, but I think it will help us a little bit. So hold on just a second. So here we are. I hope everyone can see the PowerPoint. Sorry, it is not cooperating with me. So let's go back to this start. That's always the issue, of course, is that you test things in advance, and then once the event happens, something may go wrong, but nothing major has happened. So there we go. Let's get started. So Doroga na Asmaru, The Road to Asmara, was published in spring 2016 by Clio, which is a nice respected publisher, but a publisher not primarily working with literary texts. It is primarily a publisher of historical scholarship and humanities-related nonfiction for broader readership. It is a very impressive book, coming in at over 500 pages. And the interesting cover comes from a work of contemporary Ukrainian artist Olena Besinova. So the book came out. There was one review, a positive review, but only one, that appeared in the newspaper Deň, and there was silence. So for a while, it is as if nobody was really reacting to the book, until there was one fortuitous event. And this often what helps the first book by the previously unknown author to get major renown. Oksana Zabushko, one of Ukraine's leading contemporary writers, and whose work has been widely translated internationally, received an inquiry from a publisher in Ethiopia about translating her famous novel from the 1990s, Field Work in Ukrainian Sex, into Amharic, the main state language of Ethiopia. She thought that she would try to find out more and to write a preface to get more of a context for the Ethiopian readership. And to her surprise, somebody told her there is just this new Ukrainian novel that was published that is primarily set in Ethiopia. And she was shocked, pleasantly. She read the book. She was absolutely absorbed in the book. It proved to be a really impressive page turner. And I can relate to that as well, because when I finally was able to read the book about a year later in the spring of 2017, I had the similar experience. I read the book very, very quickly. I was really absorbed in it. And she started consistently championing the book in Ukrainian media. She featured the author in the special series of public events she organized at the Knyazkovy Arsenal, the Book Arsenal Literary Festival, which happens in Kyiv every spring in 2017. She had a series of one-on-one dialogues titled Розкажи мені про мене, Tell Me About Myself. One of the featured speakers was Boston area's own Аскольд Мельничук, and the other one was Serhiy Synhaivsky. And she spoke a lot there about what is good and interesting and valuable about the book. And with her enthusiastic championing of it, critics started paying attention. So in 17, 18, 19, reviews have been trickling in. However, the reviews, even though they were overwhelmingly positive, have not resulted in the book reaching a very wide readership. The original hardcover edition was printed in only 1,500 copies. It is sold out and the book is out of print. It is available as an ebook, but only on one platform, on Fiol, which is a bit of a clunky and a complicated to use platform, in my personal opinion. And worldwide, it has reached some libraries. I specifically went into WorldCat and saw that it is in 9 libraries in the Western world, including 7 here in the US, including both Widener Library and the library here at the University of Kansas. So that I'm very happy about. But it is a book that's so richly deserves to be so better, so much more broadly known, that I hope we can today, that this event in a small way contributes to the recognition that I think the book richly deserves. So about the author, here you see a photo of Serhiy Synhaivsky. He was born in 1957 in Kyiv. The book is his literary debut. He has been professionally active primarily as a translator from and into English. And it's actually thanks to that side of his professional activities that I was able to get in touch with him, because he has worked as a translator of art history monographs for the wonderful Ukrainian publishing house Rodovid, that I've also cooperated with, and whose founder, Lydia Lihach, is a close personal friend of mine. So thanks to her, I was able to get in touch with the author and meet with him. His family roots are in the Zhytomyr area. Both his father and his uncle are poets. They're not, I think, very well-known poets, but they are respected poets. I guess we can place him tentatively as somebody who is related to the so-called Zhytomyr school of Ukrainian literature. But as I said, he was born and has lived all his life, was based in Kyiv. He graduated from the Kyiv Taras Shevchenko University in 1979. And very importantly for us, and very faithfully, he served in Ethiopia as a Soviet military interpreter in 1984-87. And it's those experiences that many years later, he was able to transform into this wonderful novel. So a little bit about the novel itself. You see the map here of Ethiopia and Eritrea, and highlighted is a Tigray region, which recently again was in the news. And this is something that is prominent also in the novel itself. The novel has 2 intertwining narratives. One set in 2012, the other set in 1984-5-6. And so in both cases, it's the time in between. In Ukraine, it's the time between the revolutions, sort of before the Revolution of Dignity in the modern time. And in the mid-80s, it is before the start of perestroika. So the Soviet Union is in the middle of stagnation. The war in Afghanistan is going on. And the Soviet Union is also beginning to intervene in the events that are happening in Ethiopia. And the key event here is something that folks who are a little bit older in the audience probably remember very well, and some younger people might be familiar with as well. And this is the Ethiopian famine of 1983-85. It's a disaster that received global resonance. and it primarily affected the northern part of Ethiopia, including the Tigray region, Eritrea, and also northern provinces of what is now Ethiopia that border Eritrea and Sudan. Many people fled the famine to Sudan, the estimate, according to the United Nations, there are about 1.2 million people who died during the Ethiopian famine. Some scholars dispute that figure and put the low estimates at around 500,000 people, but still it was a disaster that received global attention. So Western countries, Britain, the United States, and others would be airlifting food supplies under the aegis of the United Nations and the Red Cross. Mother Teresa was there and was trying to help. And given that Ethiopia was then ruled by a Soviet-allied military dictatorship, which officially was called the Provisional Military Government of Socialist Ethiopia, otherwise known as the DERG. It was in power from 1974 when monarchy was overthrown till 1991 when the Soviet Union fell apart, coincidentally. So famine was something that was instrumentalized politically for the regime of Mengistu Haile Mariam, the military dictator, to enforce control over the country. And the northern area is the areas that have long waged struggle for autonomy and independence. Eritrea used to be a separate country. It was for a while an Italian colony. It was granted independence at the end of World War II, but then United Nations decided to unite it in a federation with Ethiopia. And then in 1961, Ethiopia unilaterally abandoned the federation and incorporated Eritrea as a province into the country. And basically, almost immediately, the Eritrean War of Independence began. And finally, in the 90s, Eritrea became independent. So this is the background. So what we see is in the story of the novel, Eritrea and Tigray become in some ways analogized to the story of Ukraine within the Russian colonial empire, even though, of course, it's not an absolute parallel. And the use of famine for political purposes, even though it's not a denied famine, in this case, it's actually very much an officially accepted famine, but a famine that was instrumentalized politically is given parallels to Holodomor in Ukraine. And I think this is a very, very important, and the argument that the novel makes is very, very powerful in this respect. Just filling in as a context, Soviet transports were used to supposedly airlift starving peasants to the southern part of Ethiopia, which was not affected by the famine. But what it created was actually taking away the local support from the guerrilla fighters. At the same time, the Soviets were not taking part in actually bringing the food supplies. They would bring in tractors or something else like that, but it was more heavy equipment that could be used for military purposes. And officially, the Soviet mission was also a peace mission, but it was staffed entirely by the military and the KGB. And so this was one of the important elements of the mission, is that Andriy, the protagonist and the part of the novel set in the 80s, and all his fellow members of the Soviet team, they had to not disclose to any locals or any of the representatives of other countries, and they do interact a bit. And in the novel, this becomes quite significant that the interaction include a Ukrainian woman from a diaspora and an Irish woman who also knows about, you know, Irish famine and Ukrainian famine. So the book positions those things very well, but Again, I am talking about the clues here, and I do not want to the audience to have an impression that this is an ideological romana thèse. This is actually a beautifully written, absorbing work of fiction with a captivating semi-detective plot, which is why Zabushko in her 2017 introduction of Synhaivsky compared some aspects of the book to the writings of Graham Greene. But it does involve serious important discussions of of all those contexts. The city of Asmara becomes a important symbol here. And the road to Asmara is a name that is meant metaphorically because in Ethiopia, apparently there is a proverb that says that the road to Asmara leads through Addis Ababa. So in other words, the Eritrean hopes and dreams are controlled by the central government in Ethiopia. Asmara is a city which is a UNESCO World Heritage Site. It is located on a high elevation from the Red Sea. And because of that, like the many cities of Central America, think of Mexico City, for example, it has a so-called eternal spring climate. The temperature hovers year round in the low 20s centigrade, which is low 70s Fahrenheit. The city has one of the world's largest collections of constructivist and Art Deco architecture, and it's certainly unique in that respect in Africa. It was a planned city with wide roads and is considered an architectural marvel. But of course, there is a very complicated relationship to that in Eritrean history because this happened when it was an Italian colony. And so the relationship between the local aspiration, the Italian influence, the relationship to Eritrea and Ethiopia, they all become sort of this in complicated ways intertwined. Coming back to the temporal context, one aspect of the Ethiopian famine that put on a global map was the Life Aid concert that took place in July 1985, which was one of those really famous live musical events that nearly 2 billion people tuned in. Basically, the entire Western world, except for the Soviet bloc and China, who did not participate. It became very famous for the set that Queen did, starring Freddie Mercury. And the recent Freddie Mercury biopic features the Life Aid concert as a culmination point. So it hopefully brought back the awareness of those events to another generation. And so that and the ignoring of by the Soviet Union of the Life Aid project is a prominent part of the novel too. And then of course, the fact that it overlapped in part with the Chernobyl catastrophe in Ukraine, that is something that also features in the text. Sorry. So some more contexts that I wanted to bring in, and those are contexts that are more important for us in situating this wonderful book in the context of Ukrainian literature and also global literatures. It, to me, is an essential new contribution to the Ukrainian literary tradition of anti-colonial solidarity, of which Shevchenko's poem Kavkaz, a wonderful text that remains and retains and whose relevance is reinvented so again and again. Think of Serhiy Synhaivs'ky reciting it at Euromaidan. It is the founding text, and it's an important text because we have here solidarity of a Ukrainian with the local indigenous population of the Caucasus that is now suffering the colonial war being waged by Russia, and at the same time also mourning Shevchenko's dear friend, Yakiv the Balmen, who died in that war, as a Ukrainian who served in a colonial war of a Russian Imperial Army, so fighting not for his own cause, not for his country, but for someone else's imperial project. And the fate of Andriy, the protagonist of the 1980s part of the novel, is also very much a parallel to that. He too ends up being a soldier in a colonial war by the Soviet Imperial Army, something that leads him to discover different things. It's the growth of his consciousness is the central, and awareness of himself is a central part of what happens in the book, in its otherwise really absorbing and complicated and captivating plot. It's this arc of transformation that we have for him, and then for Mikita, the character who is the protagonist in the 2010s part of the book. We have in contemporary Ukrainian studies fiction a lot of good work being written on this kind of solidarity, and especially here would like to highlight the work of my dear friend and former graduate student from my Columbia days, Rory Finnan, who now is a professor at Cambridge University in the UK, who has been writing about this, especially in the context of the Crimean Tatar deportations and responses to the fate of the Crimean Tatars from Ukrainian literature, both Ukrainophone and Russophone, and Russophone, the writer Boris Chichibabin from Kharkiv. Rory traces it from the early works depicting Crimean Tatars set in Crimea by Lesya Ukrainka and Mikhail Kutsubinsky to recent efforts in contemporary Ukraine post the Russian annexation of Crimea. And we also have examples of solidarity across time and space that happen in Ukrainian literature. And in the PowerPoint, I highlighted in particular contemporary Ukrainian writing, especially Mariana Kianovska's amazing collection of poetry, Babin Yar Holosami, for which she very deservedly was awarded the Shevchenko Prize. And the poetry of a wonderful Ukrainian Israeli Canadian poet, Alexandra Verbuch, who now is a PhD candidate at the University of Toronto, and whose poetry is very much this kind of poetry of solidarity and identification with the past. And he writes about both the Jewish community of modern day Ukraine and also the deportees during the war, folks who are non-Jewish Ukrainians, who are DP camp survivors. So this sort of empathy and solidarity is a crucial part of his poetics. And we see that early in the 20th century too, some of these texts are better known, some of them are less known. And interestingly, mostly they are poetic texts. Think of Vasil Simonenko's poem to the Kurdish brother, Kurdskomu Bratovi. Or in a different genre, we have travel writing by a wonderful Western Ukrainian author, Sofia Yablonska, who traveled a lot through North Africa and then East Asia and wrote about it, and her work was published in the 1930s, then forgotten, and more recently revived. Another important context for Synhaivsky's novel is the recent prominence of historical fiction in Ukraine. One can say that perhaps Oksana Zabushko's massive novel, The Museum of Abandoned Secrets, inaugurated this trend, but I would also place within it such wonderful recent works as Sofia Andruchowicz's novels, Felix Avstria and Amadoka, Vasil Makhno's novel, Vichny Kalendar, and several other texts by Tanya Malarchuk, for example. So there is this really important and interesting way of trying to engage with the past and make it relevant. Of course, historical fiction is about the past, but it is for the present. This book shares some elements with it in that we have Ukrainian past and Ukrainian present, but very importantly, it also uses this recognizing oneself of an other across territory, across a racial distinction, but through shared colonial histories, similar colonial histories. This is what it shares with many texts of global post-colonial writing. And to me, one of the greatest parallels here, one of the most poignant parallels, is a novel by Sudanese writer Tayeb Salih called Season of Migration to the North. And this is a book that was published in Arabic in 1966 and then in English in 1969. It still has not been translated into Ukrainian. It was translated into Russian in the Soviet days, but the translation is not very good, and the book is still not very well known and appreciated in the post-Soviet region. And Salih engages with Conrad's Heart of Darkness, which is, of course, is an important intertext for Synhaivsky as well. It's not anything that he quotes with or engages with directly, but in this dialogue with Zabushko at the Mestetsky Arsenal in 2017, he emphasized the importance of Heart of Darkness as a predecessor text, and also express simultaneously his regret at it not having been translated into Ukrainian until very recently, but also his happiness that finally, after the Revolution of Dignity, we now have three different translations of Heart of Darkness that were published in very recent years. So a little more about the book's structural organization. As I mentioned several times already, there is a part set in the 1980s, and there is a part, and I think I'm going to stop sharing temporarily and go back to the regular screen, and the part set in the 2012. And in the 1980s, we have a diary that the character from the 2012 reads, but also then a third person narrative as well. So we have three different types of narratives, third person narrative 2012, third person narrative 1984, 85, 86, and the diary 1984, 85, 86. The linkage is that the character from the 2000s learns on his mother's deathbed that the person who he thought was his father is not his biological father, and he's given the diary of his biological father by his mother, and then he's finally reading it, and he learns a lot about himself, about history, and try to make a sense of who is he, where he belongs. Very importantly, the person who he thought of as his father is a retired Soviet high-ranking KGB officer who then figures out in the 1980s part of the narrative as well. So we then have a reckoning and a change and a trying to come to terms with the complicated legacies that this 2012 character has, and also his recognition of some aspects of himself in the experiences of the biological father. And this very, very rich story from the 80s, the travel to Ethiopia, beginning with taking a train from Moscow to Mykolaiv, the sailing from Mykolaiv to the Red Sea, to Massawa on Shotaru Staveli, which is one of the Soviet cruise liners that was part of Black Sea Shipping Company, and that they had to pretend for the world that these were cruise passengers. So all the Soviet, you know, doubleness, and then the details, very richly drawn details of Soviet life of that team of professional interpreters and that Andriy is part of, and the interaction with the locals, interaction with other members of the Soviet military contingent, with the diplomatic corps. The book is a very richly drawn. It's a fascinating detail. And as I mentioned, it is the page turner that is really, really absorbing. And what Oksana Zabushko was infuriated by, and when she talked about this in 2017, and what I share is that there was a reaction of some people in Ukrainian elites saying that all this stuff about Ethiopia is boring and we don't want to read about it. And she was absolutely shocked by that and saw that a legacy of Soviet disdain, racist disdain towards the cultures of quote unquote non-white parts of the world, the global South, Asia, Africa, and Latin America. We have then a gradual sort of breaking through that with the fascination with Latin American modernist literature, thanks in part to the translations by Yuri Pokalchuk in the 1970s. But Africa especially remained a continent with which there was very little engagement. And that is wrong. And we see changes happening culturally. We see that in the presence of persons of Ukrainian and African mixed descent, visible in Ukraine, very often as musicians. Think of Haitana or of Miroslav Kuvaldin. There is an excellent book by Adriana Helbig, Hip Hop Ukraine, that talks specifically about this interaction between cultures with African roots and what is happening in contemporary Ukraine. But this in-depth literary engagement is pioneering, which is why Zabushko said, and I would agree with her here, that Mikita, the character in 2012, is somebody of the kind we have had before in Ukrainian literature. But Andriy, the protagonist in the 1980s part of the novel, is somebody who appears in Ukrainian literature for the first time. And it's all the more important and fascinating that we have this richly an engagingly drawn character and his journey and his evolution that we can see in the diary, because the diary, of course, is an intimate text where a person reflects on their lives and experiences and changes and the evolution in Andriy's consciousness. Very importantly, Synhaivsky would often say that Andriy is a better person than me. In a sense that he, Synhaivsky, would assert that it took for him much longer to undertake the journey of awareness, the journey of recognition, the journey of developing this deep solidarity with the other and discovering and recognizing and seeing strongly all these parallels between what he saw in Ethiopia and Eritrea in the 80s and aspects of Ukrainian history, especially Holodomor, but also other aspects of Ukraine's part of the Russian and then Soviet colonial empire. And so he nudges this character who is partly autobiographically based, but is not in any way a direct reflection of Synhaivsky's experiences other than sort of the army side of things. He nudges him further in this identity transformation. And this, I think, is something that, therefore, I think is hugely important for wider Ukrainian audiences to read, but also for global audiences to read and appreciate, because it gives us a new voice and a new perspective and a new event in the context of Ukrainian literature. We see similar interesting new developments happening in some other literatures of Central and Eastern Europe in engagement with otherness, but very often it's the otherness that is already here. For instance, in Czech literature, one of the leading Czech writers of the post-communist era, Jachim Topol, writes a lot about the Vietnamese community in Prague, who started as guest workers back in the days of communist rule, and then the Vietnamese community remained strong and visible to even a greater extent than, you know, the Vietnamese community we have in some cities in Ukraine, including in my native Odessa, where there is now a large, you know, Vietnamese neighborhood, actually, which is leads in a very separate existence, and there is very little cross engagement. And I am alarmed and worried about this ghettoization, and I don't think that that is a good thing. And we see similar kind of experiences. The colleagues who have studied refugees from the non-Soviet area passing through Ukraine, or Oksana Shevel especially has done a lot of great work on that. So what happens to, say, refugees from Afghanistan who end up in Troyeshchina? And again, in this case, I think the fact that in Ukraine, we have very symbolically Mustafa Nayim as a prominent figure of that background, and who had a very prominent role in Revolution and Dignity, would hopefully perhaps lead people to look at the situation differently. So in other words, there is a lot that by gaining through reading this novel, by thinking about it and appreciating what the author was trying to do, is there's a lot that would really enrich Ukrainian audiences, both in Ukraine and globally diasporically, but also would enrich global audiences who are trying to learn about how nations of Eastern Europe are engaging in this complex global networks where we see these rich, interesting parallels developing and growing between regions in a wonderful non-hierarchic but in horizontal ways of solidarity. So this is my hope, and I very much would be happy if my presentation today nudged us a little bit towards that. So thank you so much for your attention. And before we go to the Q&A period, I want to share the final slide from my presentation. And that would be the building of Cinema Impero in Asmara. As you see, a beautiful Art Deco building, part of the UNESCO World Heritage Site, which to me is fascinating both as a symbol of that interesting place and also as a sign that imperial legacies are something that will continue to haunt us for a very long time. We should not run away and hide from them, but we need to constructively and proactively confront them. And this will help us in this post-colonial search for our own identities, in the post-colonial work of mourning for the traumas that we sustained during the colonial period. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Professor Chernetsky, for such a comprehensive and wide-ranging talk. Yes, it covers so many issues, not only literary issues, but a wide variety of political, cultural, and even existential issues that Ukrainians and also people across the world are facing now, with all those challenges. So I open the floor for discussion now, and we have already four questions in our Q&A section, and I will start from the first one. It is from Nina Basok, who is our summer school student, and her question is essentially about Oksana Zabushko's promoting the book. Ukrainians are relying on the opinion of the famous authors, so she definitely get a push, but was it crucial? So that's a question.
Okay, so I would think that the book would eventually have found an audience and received notice without her intervention. But her intervention was a helpful catalyst. And she has been doing it very energetically and in a number of interviews, columns she wrote, and so on and so forth. She names Synhaivsky novel the most important Ukrainian novel of the past decade, which some folks might disagree and say that there are other very worthy books that should be considered for that distinction too. But I think here it is important, at least, that through this effort, she's trying to help with the visibility. And the fact that I mentioned that the paper copy is out of print, it's become a bibliographic rarity, and it still has not been reprinted for reasons I'm not aware of. I'm sure that the publisher has good intentions, but there may be economic complications or pandemic-related complications. But the book definitely has been reaching the audience. And what has been happening is that after that nudge, now there are many, many more people who are discovering this book on their own. And this is a good thing because it is in libraries. It is on however clunky a platform available as an ebook. So yes, it is reaching more people, but the more the merrier.
Thank you. We have a question from Theresa Zollner, and it's about this potential colonial narrative. She asks that the book reminds her of Forster's passage to India. So are there any parallels with Synhaivsky's narrative and this colonial narrative spread, as I assume, still in the 19th century and even earlier?
He does not directly engage with passage to India, but it does not mean that passage to India is not an intertext to it. It may be an intertext to Synhaivsky, even though he may not have been aware of it. Passage to India, of course, is a wonderful text where the characters stew. I mean, it's the caves episode where they have that transformation. There is this element of magic realism that is present in Synhaivsky's novel that I think is important and that could be seen as an especially poignant intertext coincidence, perhaps intentional, with a passage to India, because in Synhaivsky's novel too, it's mostly psychological realism, but there are several crucial magic realist moments within it. So as a realist novel with a little dose of magic realism in it, I think it in many ways is akin, as of the same type of a narrative as Passage to India in that respect.
We have a question from another participant of our summer school, the Nolistician, and he asked about the links between the road of Asmara and Shevchenko's Kavkaz. Does Synhaivsky interact with the poem in the text? If so, how?
Not directly, but it is something that he has acknowledged elsewhere as an antecedent and as a text that he sees his book in a tradition with. So he is very much claiming that he is part of that tradition that starts with Kavkaz in Shevchenko's Kavkaz in Ukrainian literature, but the book is not in a direct open dialogue with it. So I guess he was hoping that the readers would recognize it without him sort of forcing it over their heads, but it definitely is something that is clear in his mind.
We have a next question from Dr. Marta Bogachevska-Chomiak, and she writes about the parallels from the 1960s. Mentioned that Synhaivsky was a part, and I assume that was his father.
Father and uncle, both of them are important members of the 60s generation.
The question follows then. In 1962, Dzhuba and Korotich tried to establish a program of visiting the other Soviet republics. I guess that's a question about the context, and I would add from myself, does Ukraine have this tradition similar to what the Poles have, Ryszard Kapuściński, for example? Mm-hmm. Yes, the genre of reportage blurring various boundaries, yes, turn into a fiction. So does Synhaivsky's work belong to this kind of genre that's by and large absent in Ukraine, or maybe it's not absent, that's already from me?
Well, I would say that yes, the fact that he grew up in the Shestadesyatniki Kolo as a young man, as a child, as a teenager, is certainly was a very important part of his consciousness. And yes, I would say that in Ukrainian, at least mass readership, it would be the travel writings of Vitaly Korotich, who became one of the officially sanctioned in Ukrainian writers who was allowed to travel and write about his travels around the world. And similarly, Yuri Pokalchuk and his engagement with Latin America in the 70s, which was the one outlet that he was allowed to legally publish while his other work was not allowed for publication, is also in that sense an important antecedent. But the difference between this text and those kind of works, whether it's Kapuściński sort of for Polish and global audiences, and or Korotich for Ukrainian / Soviet audiences when he was writing in the late 60s and 70s, is that this is a work of fiction. It's a well put together work of fiction that is based on literary things. It is a work of fiction that in its tradition, in its type of diction as writing, it has a continuity with Ukrainian writers who tried to fight through the censorship and get published legally, even though they officially, I mean, they often encounter challenges. I would mention Valery Shevchuk, from the fellow Zhytomyr region-tied person, as somebody who could not publish for about a dozen years, but who very much was working in these kind of magic realist-like historic writings. So think of his Dimna Hori and Trivistki za Viknom, these two crucial novels written in the 70s, published in the 80s, that engage with the psychological aspects and the character's personal journey and things of that kind, and especially Trivistki za Viknom. I think this is very much pertinent. Some readers and periodical reviewers in Ukraine brought up Zaharebelny here, but I think Zaharebelny is less of an apt parallel here in my opinion, because Zaharebelny is somebody who was much more about navigating how to stay, you know, afloat in the Soviet censorship context. I mean, there would be wink, wink, nudge, nudge. I would say an interesting parallel would be in terms of solidarity would be Roman Ivanichuk's novel Malvy, which was published in 1968, and which is set in a Crimean Khanate and shows Crimean Tatars in a very sympathetic and positive light, which was not something how the tradition was portraying them before. And in that, especially given the fact that, you know, this was during the time when the deportation was still not acknowledged, and this, you know, they were not able to come back to Crimea, what Ivanichuk did in that novel was definitely important.
Thank you. We have a question from our YouTube audience, and this is from Dr. Emily Channel Justice. She thank you for the wonderful talk and her question. The post-colonial, anti-colonial perspective seems to be more developed in the field of literature than in history or social sciences in Ukraine. So why do you think that's the case, and how might we work to correct it? Is this a relevant framework in more fields?
I think that I mean, I am a literature and culture scholar myself, so it would be a bit rich for me to tell historians, anthropologists, sociologists what they should be doing in their fields. What I think is in different places, there are different origins of how particular discourse enters. And in Ukrainian case, the discourse on post-colonialism came in through literary scholarship, through the pioneering work of Marko Pavlishin, and then picked up by several other colleagues, by Tamara Hundrova, for example. You know, I've been making my own efforts. Several other colleagues, you know, more recently have been very actively joining that too. We see this awareness happening a bit more also in discourse about visual arts, interestingly enough. So Jessica Zachowicz's book about contemporary Ukrainian protest art in this sense is a good example. But this is, I think, the question of what sort of engagements we have with kind of theoretical fields. I mean, in history and in social sciences, there seems to be more of an impact of the kind of travel theories do travel and travel in interesting ways. Edward Said has a whole long reflection on traveling theories, came via the social sciences in the case of Russia and Belarus, and to some extent also Central Asia. So Ukraine in this sense shows that it's different. So in that it's actually closer to other places like countries of Central Europe or the Baltic countries where a lot of this kind of scholarship is being done within literature and culture studies. But definitely I see room and the need for this kind of engagement. I think what helps is that in literary scholarship, there's a tradition of a set of tools as we can take a text, be it Synhaivsky or be it Tayyip Salih or another crucial sort of work, and see what is at stake there. So when we try to analyze, uncover new dimensions of a particular work of literature or a work of cinema, a work of another sort of art, it is easier than to have this kind of engagement go on as opposed to perhaps an archival or research on human subjects survey kind of work that may be more demanding. But this should not stop colleagues in those fields who rely on those types of research methodologies of trying to do that.
We have around 6 questions and probably 18 minutes. So it will be hard probably to answer all these great questions actually, but we'll try, I guess. Question from Anna Vozna. Could you please elaborate how the whiteness of the main character is negotiated in the novel? And could you please speak more about negotiating Slavic whiteness in the context of building post-colonial solidarity? That's a big question.
This is a wonderful question. Thank you so much. And it's really crucial. And I think this is something that is highly important for us. And this is, Soviet prejudices and that persist, unfortunately, in the post-Soviet period play a huge role, because for many Soviet people, the first Black persons they encountered were students from the newly independent countries of Africa who came to study in Soviet universities, including in Ukrainian universities in the 1960s, 1970s. And very often they lived very isolated lives, and they experienced either curiosity or rejection and a lot of othering and negative stereotyping that we have persisting even in Soviet era mass culture. So the in-depth engagement of the kind that Andriy, the 1980s protagonist, experience says that is something that is a journey that we take on with him. And it's by seeing both the beauty, the physical beauty of the people of the African Horn region. And this is not for, you know, accidentally that a place of so many fashion models come from. Think of Iman, David Bowie's wife, who is Somali, so from neighboring countries, and a lot of, you know, people from Ethiopia, Eritrea, Somalia are people of a stunningly physical beauty. But at the same time, he sees these people suffering and dying, the very horrible conditions of the famine, of the repressions of the Ethiopian dictatorship, that creates this visceral solidarity. But yes, we have a difference in that Andriy breaks that barrier. And a lot of his Soviet teammates remain racist SOBs. So there's something in him that predisposed him to take that step. And perhaps when Synhaivsky says that, you know, Andriy is a better person than I was, is that probably Synhaivsky acknowledges that for him it was a longer, more difficult journey to break out of his whiteness and to develop this kind of solidarity. But writing from the position of today, from the 20-teens, he very much emphasizes that need. And so the solidarity across race as an artificial construct, as we all know, is hugely, hugely important.
Thank you. Another question from our summer school student, Yusuan Su. Could you elaborate more on the trail of writing repertoire of fiction and works of Ukrainian literature written in the 1920s and 30s? So again, it's a big question, but
huge question. I am not sure I would be able to do it justice in the very short time that we have here. I would mention first and foremost Sofia Yablonska, who did travel through North Africa and China and wrote about it and published her work, and it was republished more recently, and it is experiencing a lot of a revival of interest in Ukraine. There was also literary reportage and travel writing by Soviet Ukrainian writers, and this is something that Yarina Cimbal and her series of books Nashi Dvatsyati is a huge sort of place where highly important place where we can find a lot of really, really wonderful works. We have everything there from detective fiction to romance novels to, very importantly, travel writing. So the serious travel writing, the volume of travel writing, unfortunately right now, its title escapes me. Oh yeah, it is Shlyakhy pod Sonchem. Shlyakhy pod Sonchem is the travel writing book I was frantically searching on the internet while I was answering your question. And Valerian Polishchuk and Sava Holovanivsky are examples of that time of tribal writers that she included in that volume. So Shlyakhy pod Sonchem, Reportaj 20-х rokiv as an anthology of tribal writing, and Sofia Yablonska and her books about North Africa and China, published in the 1930s, but in Western Ukraine, in Lviv.
Another question from our student, Yulia Kazanova, and she asks about a potential tension in the book between novel as literary fiction and novel as testimony, in tradition of the Holocaust literature or a roman document in Anatoly Kuznetsov's term. Yeah, that, and a tension or balance between these two.
Thank you so much for a great question. I think that because the text from the 1980s in the novel is a diary, a fictional diary, as opposed to documents, what we have in Kuznetsov's Baben Yar, or in other kind of texts that we have in terms of dealing with the Holocaust legacies. But with the Holocaust writing, I think this is where we perhaps see more of an potential intertext and interdependence. I think it is a productive tension in that the book does do an important work of bringing of the kind of visceral, from the ground, real, powerful, grabbing sense of what the Ethiopian famine of the 80s was like for an eyewitness. But it is presented in the sort of this slightly distanced form of a diary. And of course, what happens with the diary, it's the person changes as the diary evolves. So here, to me, I think, actually, thank you for bringing up Holocaust literature. Imre Kertész's great novel, Faithlessness, is an example of that, because Gyurka, the protagonist of Kertész's novel, we have his narrative in the present. So as he lives in Budapest, as he is deported to Auschwitz, as he is transferred to another camp, as he survives and comes back, it all happens in the present. So the character does not know. So we as readers might know what might await him, since, you know, he is going to Auschwitz, and but we don't know. The same thing happens to Andriy. Of course, we know that Andriy is dead. We know it fairly early in the book. And so it's us reading with Mikita, the 2012 protagonist, Andriy's diary, and finding out gradually what was going on, the rich context. So that creates this complicated, and I think is really fascinating dynamic.
I will unite two questions from Darina Sudacik and Sean Connery to other our students. The question of perception of the novel, either in Russia and in Ukraine, among various circles. Sean asked about perception among veterans of the Soviet war in Afghanistan or Russo-Ukrainian war today, and perception in Russia. That was the first question.
I am absolutely not aware of any Russian responses to this book. In general, in Russia, we have this big divide in Russian society between people who are, liberal folk who try to find out more about Ukraine, but they're much more focused on contemporary Ukraine, on the aftermath of Revolution of Dignity and things of that kind. So they might engage with the work of Serhiy Jadan, or they might engage with the writing of Alexa Verbuch, because the Holocaust is an important topic, or Mariana Kianovska's work. This novel has not yet reached the Russian intellectual horizons. And it's interesting because in general, this is also what happened, for instance, with just post-colonial thought and post-colonial practices in Ukraine. Russians fundamentally misread, for example, early on Yuri Andropovich's novel Moskoviada, and I was really shocked by the kind of misreadings that it was given. And it was sort of this visceral sort of shock of recognition saying, no, I'm not like that. But if you're saying I'm not like that, it becomes this Freudian denial. It means that you did recognize yourself in that. Throughout the 1990s, when Ukrainians started seriously engaging with post-colonial discourse, responses from Russia was, what is this absurd nonsense? And then Russians find the post-colonial discourse in the early 2000s, and they claim, of course, that they found it for the first time of any group in the on the post-Soviet region, and absolutely ignoring the Ukrainian tradition that at that point was, you know, more than 10 years old. So this is sort of the context that we are operating in. And this is not to blame individual good, Russian folks for not having discovered the book yet, and I hope that they will, and I hope that they will engage with it seriously. It'll be an interesting challenge, of course, of how the text that is so polyphonic and plays with literary Ukrainian, Soviet Army slang, English, and, you know, quoting things from Amharic and Oromo, which is another prominent language, and Tigrinya, I think, and other, so different languages of the African Horn region. Rendering it into Russian is going to be particularly difficult. It'll be difficult into English too, but given the distance, English actually perhaps is a little easier. In terms of war in Afghanistan, this is something that Zabushko actually emphasized in that 27 event from Knyazhkovy Arsenal, which is available on YouTube, and I encourage folks to watch it. Those of you who are fluent in Ukrainian, I will post it in chat now for those who are joining us on Zoom, and I hope the moderators can also help on other platforms. So this is the link to the Zabushko and Synhaivsky dialogue. The video is about 2 hours long, well worth it. So you might not watch it in one sitting, but I strongly encourage you to do that. And this is the topic of Afghanistan, and the fact that this is a missing experience is in Ukrainian literary consciousness that has not received its due attention. That is something that Zabushko brings up as well.
Thank you. And probably we have a question, time for 1.5 questions. Mm-hmm. The larger question is from Natalia Druhak, also our student, and she asks whether Synhaivsky as a translator was sensitive to the aspects of local culture. Was there any aspects of local culture reflected in the novel? And quite a simple question, is there any plans for any English translation from Mark Balaguer?
Very simple. The second one, yes, I promised Synhaivsky that I will translate the novel, but I would, given other commitments, I would not be able to start on it until at least a year from now. So I told him if he can find another translator sooner than that, you know, more power to that person. I'll be only supportive. But if no other translator can commit to the project, I promised him that I will do that. And absolutely, he very richly engages with different local cultures. I mentioned Oromo, which is actually the widest spoken language in Ethiopia, in the southern part of the country. It's actually spoken by more people than Amharic, but Oromo speakers are historically discriminated in Ethiopia. So there is a very long and interesting engagement with Oromo folk in the novel. And of course, the Tigrinya and Eritreans in the north. So there is very respectful, very rich engagement with the multiculturalism and multilingual situation of Ethiopia and Eritrea. Synhaivsky does a wonderful, very respectful job. He also shows the prejudice of the Soviets, who do not care much about that, you know, at least the military and KGB folk. But Andriy, our good guy, protagonist. I mean, he is not flawless. I mean, he has his flaws and troubles. I mean, he's a complicated three-dimensional character, but in his evolution, a crucial thing is that his respectful, rich engagement with the diversity of local cultures.
I like our timing. We're on time. That's perfect. Thank you. I want to thank our speaker, Professor Chernetsky, for this excellent presentation. In our audience for the excellent discussion. And it was a very interesting discussion. And I learned myself personally a lot because I was not familiar with the novel and with this trend, I would say probably trend in contemporary Ukraine, Ukrainian literature. Thank you again. And I hope I'll see you all next Friday. We will have a presentation by Professor Polohi about Ukraine and the Cuban Missile Crisis. That's will be another fascinating topic. Continue on international aspects of Ukraine history. Thank you so much. and see you next Friday. Have a great day, evening, and a weekend.